Jace Rack.
And James.
Myths, Legends, and Lies. Where in the hell are we at today, James?
We are at Casa Grande Ruins, the big house.
You know, if it's the big house, why are these doors so damn small? So let me get out of here and let me... I'm going to guess they were shorter. What do you think?
They're probably more like my size.
So, what a fabulous place. You know, you just really don't... You know, we've been here before, and we just didn't spend the time to really do the kind of work it's going to take. You know, we're at the Casa Grande Ruins. Now, a lot of people don't even know that if you would go to the north side of the administration building, you're going to see something that, if I told you that the oldest sport was over 2,700 years old of continuous play, what would you think that was? Because a lot of times with these cultures, we think all they did was work, 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 right? But that's not true. If you'll take a look right over here, what you're going to see is an ancient ball court. Now, they used a ball made of stone that was a little bit larger than a hard ball, and they played, just like we do in our sports culture, games, and it was just as important to them as it is to us today.
So we were just learning that the descendants of the people that sometimes are referred to as the Hohokam think of that term as offensive, huh?
They find that term extremely offensive, and they would be rather be called the ancients. That's what they feel more comfortable with in their society today is the ancients.
The ancients, the ancestors,
yes.
Correct?
Absolutely.
Awesome. Okay. Well, that's a cool little fact to know.
It is. Absolutely.
We're talking
is.
About this
yeah.
stuff is Hohokam is considered offensive. So we are going to continue to refer to them as the ancestors.
The ancestors or the ancients, I think it'd be, you know, I think that, and that's the thing that's real funny about this, James, is that we want to look at a lot of things in kind of a square box, and the reality of a lot of this stuff is, first off, we don't know exact dates and things like that.
Exactly.
Second off, we don't know exact meetings and exact games that they played. But it's really interesting to really, if you sit down on one of these benches out here and you really think about the culture. You know, a lot of people don't realize that they really were four different times in this period of this culture, right?
Yes.
So the first one would be the pioneer.
Correct.
The second would be the colonial.
Yep.
Sedentary, and then the classic.
Correct.
And the classic was the last era of which they moved out of here around 1450.
Yep. That's what we heard. Yep.
So, and each one of those different time frames had an advancement in the technology, mm-hmm. and changed each one of the evolutions of the farming, of the architecture, of the actually of how they built the pots.
Yes,
you
yes.
know, so they're different throughout those different
and
frames.
Developments in the art itself, and that's what the result of the big house is the classic period.
You know, one of the most amazing things about the big house, though, to me, James, is
that
it was the pinnacle of all those years, right? So they built the big house basically last, and then within 100 years, the whole place was...
They moved on. Yeah.
After 100, so did they get too big? Was that symbol of how big they were was also the weight that probably broke them down?
Yeah, we're going to talk about that more because it was really is fascinating that no one really knows.
That's unbelievable, isn't it?
Yeah, and that kind of ties into the descendants of these people are like, well, they didn't just disappear. They didn't vanish.
Right.
They're
here. Right. They're us.
They're
yeah.
like, we've lived here since. So.
Yeah.
So it's cool. We're going to kind of investigate that more, I think, as we move on.
Well, let's go take a look at the big house. But don't forget, when you're out here, don't miss the court. You know, probably one of the most historical figures in the Southwest would be a Catholic priest, and his name would be Father Kino. Now, Father Kino basically went all over the Southwest, and not only did he find things, and not only did he try to convert the natives to Catholicism, right? He also took time, when he found any type of structure, measured it, and actually put these into record books. So when he found this location, he called it Casa Grande. Now, Casa Grande in Spanish means the big house. Now imagine this location 900 years ago. And remember, at that time, at the height of the population of this village, there were over 2,000 residents. And if we look over this courtyard, imagine Ramat is filled with goods to trade and to sell. And then the crown jewel of this village was the big house. Imagine how impressive it would have been at that time to have a four-story building. It would have almost been mind-boggling, the advancements and the feel that how life in the village at that time must have been really a great experience. So here we are, Casa Grande, the big house. And when you think about how old this is, the first thing you need to realize is it's four stories tall. If you think about when this was built and the ability to be able to build this structure four stories high is pretty incredible when you think about the fact that the tools that they had to build this were pretty primitive. So when you think about the work that they did on this structure with very little equipment, become advanced enough that they could think about things like this. You know, when your demand for food is more important than anything else, and then shelter, you know, you don't get a lot into the arts. But what you find out in this civilization and this culture is that that's not the way it was. They were building these structures that were unbelievable. Their art was unbelievable, the weaving that they did, the pottery that they did. When a culture starts to do the art on bowls and pots, it means that they have time to be able to decorate things because they're not stressing about just eating, which the rural cultures do. So this is an indication of the advancement of this culture is this structure right here. Now let's take a look at this. Look at the thickness of the walls. That's the first reason that you probably realize that that's why this structure is still in place. Now, if you look at the inner walls and you look at the graffiti, I mean, they were visiting this in the 1800s. So if you'll look right up here, which is graffiti on that wall right there, is 1870. So people have been visiting the structure since 1870, but regrettably, they've been also abusing it as well. So one of the nice things that they have done is they've built a structure, a roof over this to keep the deterioration down because of just the weather.
Another really cool thing about this particular site is it gives you a solid background on any of the other sites that you may visit when you go to the Pueblo sites, the cliff dwelling, things of that nature. This actually outdates a lot of those. So that's kind of cool too.
You know, you bring up a great point, James, is that this is on the ground, right?
Yep.
And they did have a wall all the way around this. So that was a myth too. Was there, you know, was there any fear of being overrun? Well, with 2,000 people, that pretty much alone would tell me that
it was heavily fortified.
They were heavily fortified and they had the people all to defend it.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of these people that lived up in this area over here, right? Or some of the descendants of this area that ended up going into the upper cliff areas.
The mountains and stuff.
They did for fear, right?
Yeah.
They did it to protect their area, but their life was so much harder than somebody that would be on the flatlands.
Exactly.
With water available.
No agriculture.
Exactly. So I can see people kind of, and I don't want to use the term fat and lazy, but I will use the term that they were pretty, at one time through here for a lot of different years, right?
Comfortable.
You know, they were comfortable for 900 years.
Exactly.
You know, this is the evolution of the hunter-gatherers turning into farmers.
Yep.
Which is pretty spectacular. It really is.
Absolutely.
And for this to be here this long. Now, one of the sad things about this structure that's kind of mind-boggling, I should say, is that this happened at the end of the classic period. So they built this structure, and 100 years later, they were gone. So was this the demise of the culture? Did this get to a point where the culture became too big? Because you don't realize, too, if you haven't been here, is that this whole structure revolved all kinds of different buildings. This is just one building of a bunch of buildings. So there were buildings all through here, and there were over 2,000 ancients that lived at this location at one time. So why did they leave? You know, the fact of the matter is we don't know why they left. We don't know if it was drought. We don't know if it was unrest. But one thing to think about that you don't really realize a lot of times in these ancient civilizations is this. There had to be structure in place, right? You're not going to build 2,000 miles of irrigation without somebody in control of it, somebody engineering it, somebody running the crew, somebody in charge of making sure that that work got done. So the social structure of this village of 2,000 people had to be incredible. And so this could have been a municipal building. It could have been a storage for grain. They really don't know. But one thing we do know is for four stories in that era, the engineering behind this, and for it to still be standing after all these years, is spectacular. There were structures located all over this property right here. One thing you'll notice is the size of the wall, the girth of that wall right there, which meant this facility was big. They wouldn't have put a huge wall if this wasn't a large facility as well. You know, it just didn't last through deterioration, weathering. It didn't last like the big house did. But there were structures like this all over the Gila River. One thing that was really neat was they do have a really educational video that plays for about 20 minutes. And the way this visitor center was laid out was really nice, very good displays, really told you about the ways of life at the villages back in those days, the advancements in the potteries, the way they built the structures. It was very informative, and I thought it was probably, you know, one of my favorites. It was really top-notch how this was put together, and very impressive location. And, you know, for the fact that it was free, I mean, it was unbelievable. You know, James, that's going to wrap it up for the Casa Grande ruins, but I want to tell you, what a fascinating place. What do you think?
I love it here, man. We came a little before and we didn't really take the time to enjoy it as much as we should have.
You know, I didn't think I realized how big a facility it was originally. I missed the ball courts, and that's something you don't want to miss. You know, one thing we forgot was they also, even though they used stone balls in that Mesoamerican court, they also had rubber balls. And we will save that for next time, won't we?
Yes, we will.
Rubber back in those days. Who would have thought? Jay Shrek.
James.
Casa Grande ruins. I think we did the big house, didn't we?
I think we did.
Hey, just remember, if you do like this video, what should they do, James?
You need to like and subscribe.
You know, if you hit that notification bell, what's that gonna do?
That's gonna let you know every time we put out a new video that's as interesting as this one.
Excellent. Thanks for joining us, and
like and subscribe.
Call it a day. I'll see you.